Hello and welcome to this DIY audio by RD Physics video. This is our first video of the channel, so it's a kind of an introduction to 3D printed loudspeakers, and I will also be showing some of the first speakers that we've made, the FR1 and the FR2. But first I'd like to talk about additive manufacturing and loudspeaker building in general. So additive manufacturing is by nature expensive when we're making large structures and heavy structures, because it means that we're going to need more material and more machine time. And with loudspeakers, again, you want big and you want heavy. So it's a contradictory objective, but I think there are some special use cases where additive manufacturing can actually be quite useful, especially for a do-it-yourself builder. So let's start with the cons of additive manufacturing for loudspeaker building, because I'm a negative person in general. Additive manufacturing is meant for small and complex structures. Loudspeaker enclosures are typically not that. The risk of leaks is very real. It's hard to get an airtight seal. And also the surface finish with FDM methods is quite coarse and not maybe pleasing to the eye. There are some pros, however. In additive manufacturing, complexity is free, they say. So that means that we can make any kind of vents, horns, waveguides. We can make any kind of visual design to make it aesthetically pleasing. There are a lot of opportunities in the design area, and they don't affect the manufacturing costs. When you're doing traditional woodworking, the more complex the design is, the more time you're going to spend fabricating it. But with additive manufacturing, the machine does all of the hard work and you're left with doing the design and the post-processing. Because it doesn't cost us anything extra to add complexity to the design, we can already, in the design phase, include some considerations for assembly. We can integrate functions, make it easy to post-process, make it easy to assemble. We have a lot of material choices. With the cheap additive manufacturing methods, we're limited to plastics. But within those plastics, we can have wood fillers, metal fillers, carbon fiber fillers. We can have glow-in-the-dark, we can have transparent, all kinds of colors, glossy, matte, you name it. We can even have flexible materials, rubber-like TPU materials, so very broad range of possible materials to be used. So let me show you the first loudspeakers that we made. The very first one was the FR1, and that's part of our mission to develop and build a small and practical desktop loudspeaker. And we started out with an Alpair 6 driver by Mark Audio. And we made a small spherical enclosure, about 3 liters volume. It's a one-piece print, uses only about 0.5 kilogram of filament, so it's reasonably fast and cheap to print. And it's very easy to assemble as well, except that the hole for the driver is quite small, so putting your hand inside the enclosure for fastening the binding posts is a bit tricky, but otherwise it's a very easy build. And these are the second version of that. Build the FR2s, so these are bigger. They use a bigger driver, the Alpair 7 by Mark Audio, and also a bigger enclosure. This is 5 liters and it's tuned to 60 Hertz. So we get a little more bass extension, but in my opinion, not quite enough. So a subwoofer would definitely be a good addition, this set. With loudspeaker building using additive manufacturing, we are stuck with quite lightweight and compliant structures. And there are ways we can add rigidity and mass to the structures. In the FR1, we used a noise killer. It's kind of a paint, a heavy paint, bitumen paint that we brushed on the inside of the enclosure. We managed to add about 200 grams of mass using that method. But it was quite messy and the additional weight was not that high in the end. So for FR2s, we went with a carbon fiber shell, which definitely adds some stiffness. It has a very unique look to it. It adds also significant mass, although carbon fiber composites are generally associated with lightweight structures, but with significant wall thickness here, we are adding quite a bit of mass to the enclosure as well. The FR1s had a fixed tilt of 15 degrees. With the FR2s, we made a isopod that's spelled with two D's to differentiate from Genelec. We're not ripping them off, but we have this rubber type of 3D printed stand. It stands on four pods and it allows us to tilt the loudspeaker. Not a huge range of tilt, but nevertheless, we get some adjustment. So how do these speakers sound? Well, a full range driver is typically very good when playing vocals and acoustic instruments and music that doesn't contain a lot of information. So the full range driver is not overwhelmed by the amount of information it has to reproduce. There's something very special about the Mark Audio drivers, the way they deliver detail, especially in vocals and acoustic instruments. And actually, for electronic music, these worked surprisingly well, even without a subwoofer. It's strange, but you get a significant amount of detail. And with electronic music, it's hard to tell when the sound is natural and when not. But for the detail aspect, I like these speakers. For rock and metal music, these really didn't work well at all. They definitely need some EQ to get the frequency response pleasant. And even after significant DSP, I just couldn't get these to sound right with rock and metal music. So I recommend these speakers for country music. Next video, which is upcoming, and we'll talk about the FR3, which uses an even bigger full range driver, and there's also a 3D printed subwoofer coming up, so stay tuned.